Hello, anatomy friends. We have reached our final station for the musculoskeletal lab one, so station 28. And we are going to look at some of the pelvic musculature. As I mentioned in the lecture videos, some of the perineal musculature is going to be discussed in more detail in the reproductive portion of the course. We're more focused on the pelvic diaphragm region. So these more superficial muscles here are going to be discussed later. Where we're more focused is more in this pelvic diaphragm region. The pelvic diaphragm, of course, will extend anteriorly, but it would be deep to this perineal membrane right here. So kind of from here this way, you'll talk about later. So don't worry, that will come up in subsequent portions of the course. So the coccygeus muscle is going to be the more posterior, kind of inferior one. It is going to be located right about here-ish. The coccyx would be located here because we're looking at a straight kind of inferior view, but in a lithotomy type of position with the legs or the lower limbs kind of spread in order to get a better view of this region. Now the levator ani, as we discussed, is going to be the majority of the pelvic diaphragm, but this does make the coccygeus muscle look a little bit bigger than I would typically have it, but that is because we can't see some of the levator ani because it would be deep to this portion of the perineal membrane region. But recall, the levator ani is going to be near the external anal sphincter, which is right in this region, and then it will have certain muscle fibers that are going to surround the vaginal orifice or the orifice associated with the urethra as well. So it will be a larger than you can actually see on this particular image. But I do like this image because this is kind of giving you an idea of this musculature from a lithotomy position. Now, one other muscle that we had mentioned in terms of the pelvis, and it also is going to be play a role in terms of the lower limb, is the piriformis. And the piriformis is going to have its more proximal attachment on the sacrum. And it is going to be that muscle that is going to traverse the greater sciatic notch and foramen in order to exit the pelvis, because it, like many other muscles, is going to insert on the greater trochanter of the femur. And so here you can see this is the gluteus maximus that's been reflected. This is the gluteus medius. The minimus is going to be deep to this, and then here is this piriformis that kind of jumps right out of that greater sciatic notch in order to get to the greater trochanter. And one of the reasons that I wanted to use this particular view, which is a posterior view of the gluteal region, is because the reason that piriformis is discussed often is not only because it's going to have an attachment to the greater trochanter, but because you have a lot of neurovasculature that is going to exit through that greater sciatic notch as well. And of particular importance is going to be the sciatic nerve, which you can see that sciatic nerve kind of being this large structure moving inferiorly from that greater sciatic notch and inferior to the piriformis. So if you think about this particular muscle hypertrophying, if it gets too large, it could feasibly pinch on the sciatic nerve or cause compression there. Okay, excellent. So you have made it through 28 stations of mostly the axial portion of the body with a few other things added in. And in our next lab visit, we will have a more focus on the appendicular skeleton and the muscles and joints associated with that. So as you move through here, if you're having any confusion regarding identification of some of these structures, please feel free to reach out to me with any of those questions. And I thank you for your time and attention.